Alright, so today we are going to discuss the modified priority table. The table which we had discussed in the last lecture, that was the first priority table which was given by Mendeleev on the basis of atomic masses. So he said that the properties, they are a function of atomic masses, but later on it was put forward by Moseley that the properties, they were a priori function of atomic numbers and not atomic masses. On the basis of this concept, which is known as the modern priori law, the modern priori table which was designed, that was basically based on the Mendeleev's priori table only, but the only difference was that over here we were taking now the atomic numbers instead of atomic masses. Now when this table was given, there were many we had seen abnormalities in the previous table. Like for example, there were many anomalous pairs which were present, and in those anomalous pairs, the first one, which was argon and potassium. Now we had studied in the last lecture that in case of argon and potassium, the atomic mass of argon was 40 and the atomic mass of potassium was 39. Still, potassium was placed before argon in the periodic table. Then when the atomic number was taken as the function, the atomic number of argon is how much? 18. How much? 18. And the this thing, atomic number of potassium, that is 19. So if you can see over here in the periodic table, argon is placed before potassium. So this was one, you can say, one rectification which was done when this periodic table was given. Also, the second anomalous pair was cobalt and nickel. The in case of cobalt, the atomic mass, that was 59. And in case of nickel, the atomic mass was 58.6. But still you can see over here that cobalt is placed before nickel. So this was an anomalous pair according to atomic masses. But when we are looking at the atomic numbers, the atomic number of cobalt is 27 and the atomic number of nickel is 28. So this again rectified the position of cobalt, which was kept before nickel in the periodic table. Then the third anomalous pair, that was that of tellurium and indium. Tellurium and iodine. Now the atomic mass of tellurium was 127.5, whereas that of iodine was 127. Still, iodine, that tellurium was placed before iodine. But when atomic numbers were taken, the atomic number of tellurium is 52 and that of iodine is 53. So you can see over here that tellurium, that is placed before iodine in the periodic table on the basis of atomic numbers, right? Then another anomalous pair was that of thorium and palladium. Thorium had an atomic mass of 232, whereas palladium had an atomic mass of 231, right? And then thorium was placed before palladium. So if we are looking over here in the periodic table, can you see thorium over here? Can you place thorium anywhere? Where is palladium? Palladium is over here. And thorium should be placed somewhere before palladium. It's not placed in this periodic table. So these were some of the anomalous pairs which were discussed on the basis of modified periodic table. Then the position of isotopes in the previous table, that was not discussed properly. Why? Because what happened was, in the previous periodic table, there were atomic masses which were taken as functions. And what are isotopes? Isotopes, they are atoms of same elements having same atomic number but different mass numbers. Now, if mass number is taken as one of the functions to explain the periodic table, then every isotope should be given different place. For example, if you're talking of hydrogen, hydrogen has three isotopes. So hydrogen should be given three places, one for protium, one for deuterium, and the next one for tritium. In a similar manner, carbon has two isotopes, C12 and C14. 14. So carbon should also be given different places. So this, the next periodic table, which was based on atomic numbers, as the isotopes, they have the same atomic numbers. So you can see only one place is given for hydrogen over here, right? The second place, which is given in group 7, that we will discuss later, that is due to the similarities with halogens, right? Then if you go to carbon, carbon is also given only one place. If you're talking of oxygen, oxygen has two isotopes, O16 and O18. But over here in the periodic table, you can see that oxygen is also given only one place. So the concept of isotopes and the positioning of the atoms, they were very well explained on the basis of the modern periodic table. Okay, so let's explain the modern periodic table. The modern periodic table, it consists of 9 vertical columns. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. There are 9 vertical columns starting from group 1. These are known as the groups. Starting from group 1 to 0. Okay, so 1 to 8 and then to 0. When we are talking of groups, the group 1 to 7, they are divided into A and B, right? So we have group 1, A and B. Similarly, group 2 is also divided into A and B. Group 3 would be divided, 4, right? So these groups A and B, they are known as the subgroups. Okay? The group 1 to 7, they are group 1 to 7, they are known as the normal groups. 1 to 7, they are known as the normal groups. And in the 8th group, you can see why these are known as normal groups. Normal groups because in each group there are only 2 elements present. But when we are looking at group 8, you can see that 3 elements, they are placed in the same group, right? Like iron, cobalt and nickel, they are placed in the same group. So the group 8, that is known as transition triads. Group 8 is known as the transition triads because there are 3 similar elements which are placed in this group. Right? Then we have the last group, which is 0 group, which is specifically given for all the noble gases. All the noble gases which are placed in the same group. Right? So let's again just memorize it, that the entire table, it consists of 9 groups starting from 1 to 0. 1 to 7, they are further divided into subgroups A and B, and 1 to 7 is known as the normal groups, whereas group 8 has 3 elements placed together, therefore they are known as the transition triads, and group 0 has the noble gases. Then we can also see horizontal, this thing over here, lines over here, and these horizontal lines, they are known as the periods. So how many periods we can see over here? There are going to be 7 periods. Each period over here, basically it, you can say it signifies the quantum number. For example, in the first period, we say that this is the principal shell, n is equal to 1. Similarly, n is equal to 2, so the second shell will be filled over here. N is equal to 3, n is equal to 4, n is equal to 5, 6 and 7. Okay, so the period signifies the principal shell or the principal quantum number in this table. Now when we are talking of the elements over here, we can see that the entire table, that is sectioned into the 7 periods. The first period has only 2 elements, hydrogen and helium. So this is known as a very short period. Okay, this is known as a very short period. The second and the third, they have 8 elements. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. Similarly, third also has 8. So these are known as second and third, they are known as short periods. Okay, then the fourth period, it has 18 elements. Same is with fifth period also. Fifth also has 18 elements. So both these periods, they are known as long periods. Sixth has 32 elements. So we counting sixth one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18 of these, right? And then there are 14 of F block which will be placed below this, right? So we have 14 elements after lamina. So there are 32 elements in the sixth, which is known as very long period. Okay, and then the seventh period over here, seventh period is not complete. It is only complete up to 92 atomic number. Okay, although it should also have 32 only, but it has only 6 elements up to atomic number 92. So this is also known as very long period. In total, there were 117 elements which were discovered. Now, recently there is another element which is discovered, so in total we have 118 elements which are discovered. Okay, now when we are talking of this, the group 4, 5 and 6 periods possess two horizontal rows. So 4, 5 and 6 periods are termed as even and odd series, right? So it has two horizontal rows, each of which is termed as even and odd. Over here I have placed actually the elements at the same level, but otherwise potassium is at a higher level and copper is at a lower level. So if we are counting the first members of each in the fourth, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. Okay, so if we are taking this at 8, this is known as the even series. Sorry, we are not going to consider this, not the 8th, we are only going to consider till 7. So let's count it again. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. But when we are counting this other one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and again 7, right? So these series, they are known as what? They are known as odd and even series. Okay, then after that, the last period consists of 28 elements. There should be 32, but it consists of the last period consisting of 28 elements, as the rest of the elements they are undiscovered. Clear? So this is your model periodic table. Now, it was said that similar properties, they recur after the numbers 2, 8, 8, 18, 18 and 32, right? So in general we can say 2, 8, 18 and 32, these four, the similar properties are going to again come after. Like you can see in the first period you have hydrogen and helium, then hydrogen and lithium, they will have similar properties. Then from lithium to sodium there are 8 elements, lithium and sodium will have similar properties. Then sodium to potassium again 8, they will have similar properties. So these numbers, they are known as magical numbers in the periodic table. Right? 2, 8, 18, 18 and 32. 2, 8, 18, 18 and 32. These are known as the magical numbers in the periodic table. Now when we are talking of properties, we say that there is a gradual change in properties if we are moving from left to right in a period. Okay, if we are moving from left to right in a period, there is going to be change in certain properties. Let's see what are those properties. Alright, so the first property which we are going to discuss is valency. Valency, you know, it is a property owing due to either the loss or the gain in electrons or the number of electrons in the valence shell. That is what a valency is. Okay. Now, when we are talking of valency and we are taking standard as oxygen, that is, we are forming oxides When we are traveling from left to right in a periodic table, it is seen that the valency increases from 1 to 7. Okay, so let's take example. For example, if we are taking sodium oxide. In this case, the valency of sodium, that is going to be 1. The oxidation state of sodium is 1. Then, if we are taking magnesium oxide, it is going to be 2. If we are taking aluminium oxide, it is going to be 3. Right? And then, if we are taking silicon dioxide, it is going to be 4. Okay? And then, when we go to phosphorus pentoxide, 5. Right? And if we go to sulfur trioxide, 6. And if we go to Cl2 is O7, the oxidation that is going to be 7. So the oxidation number is, or the valency is increasing from 1 to 7. If we are taking standard as oxygen. But if in case we take standard as hydrogen, then the valency increases from 1 to 4 and then decreases. Okay, so let's take an example again. We are talking of sodium hydride. We are talking of magnesium hydride. Right? Then aluminium hydride. Then we can take, or let's take the first, even you can take silanes, SiH4. So, oxidation state over here is 1, 2, 3 and 4. But when we go to phosphorus, oxidation state over here decreases to 3. And in this case, 2 and 1. Okay, so the valency, when we are taking oxygen as standard, it keeps on increasing. But if we are taking hydrogen as standard, it is going to increase up to 4 and then it starts decreasing. The second property which we are going to do, that is the metallic character. Metallic character. Now again, if we are going from left to right in a periodic table, the metallic character decreases and non-metallic character increases. Non-metallic character, that is going to increase. Like if we are talking of the third period, we say sodium and magnesium, both are metals. Aluminium is a metalloid. Then carbon, nitrogen, or if you are taking the third period, then we have silicon, we have phosphorus, we have sulfur and fluorine. All these four, they are non-metals. Okay? Silicon, phosphorus, sulfur and fluorine, all are non-metals. Clear ho gaya? Phir uske baad, the third property is electropositive character. Electropositive character and metallic character is almost the same, where electropositive character means tendency to lose electrons. Electropositive character means tendency to lose electrons. Now, as we travel from left to right in the periodic table, electropositive character keeps on decreasing and electronegative character on increasing. Therefore, the alkali metals, they are most electropositive. Alkali metals are most electropositive, whereas the halogens are most electronegative. Halogens are most electronegative. Okay, clear ho gaya? Then the next property is oxidizing and reducing nature. Oxidizing nature means what do you understand by oxidizing nature? That is the tendency to oxidize the element with which it is reacting. That is to oxidize the element means it is going to take the electrons from that element and get reduced itself. Okay, so oxidizing nature keeps on increasing along a period. Reducing character keeps on decreasing along the period. Right? So oxidizing tendency will keep on increasing and reducing tendency will keep on decreasing, as a result of which we say that sodium and magnesium, they are good reducing agents. Whereas, when we are talking of fluorine, fluorine is a good oxidizing agent. It is in fact the best oxidizing agent in the periodic table. And lithium is the best reducing agent in the periodic table. Okay? Lithium is going to be the best reducing agent and fluorine is going to be the best oxidizing agent. Okay? Then number 5 is nature of oxides. As we have discussed about the metals, that the metals may be reducing or oxidizing, in a similar manner the oxides may also be reducing or oxidizing. Or in other words, we can say that the oxides, they are classified into basic oxides and acidic oxides. You have to remember that the oxides of all non-metals, they are going to be acidic. So all non-metals, they form acidic oxides, whereas all metals form basic oxides. Okay? So if we are taking the oxides of the third period, we have Na2O, MgO, Al2O3, then we have silicon dioxide, and then after that we have sulfur dioxide, and let's take Cl2O7. Okay, and even P2O5. So here is P2O5. So what are we saying? That sodium oxide and magnesium oxide, they both are basic in nature. This is amphoteric. The rest of them, they are going to be acidic. Okay? So basic, amphoteric and acidic. Right? So these are the nature of oxides. Then the next property which we are going to do, that is typical metals. Typical metals. Right? Now what are typical metals? The typical metals, the metals of the third period, elements, metals ki jagah, I think you should write elements, which is more appropriate. Why are these called typical elements? Because they give us the summary of all the properties of that particular group. Okay? So third period ke jo hai, jaise for example, if we are taking lithium and sodium. Lithium and sodium. These are the typical elements of group 1. Why? Because they summarize the properties of the entire group. Similarly, if we are talking of beryllium and magnesium, they are typical elements of group 2 as they give us the entire properties of group 2. Right? Then we also have another kind of elements which are known as bridge elements. What are bridge elements? Bridge elements are those which is a bridging of properties between two different subgroups. Okay, like for example, when we are talking of magnesium, if we look at the periodic table once again and we are talking of magnesium, then magnesium will have similarities with calcium, strontium and barium, which are the alkaline earth metals, but at the same time it should have similarities with zinc, cadmium, that is the elements of group B, and mercury. Okay, so what are we saying? That magnesium over here, that is a bridging element between subgroups, subgroup A and subgroup B. These are the bridge elements. Clear? Okay. Fir, then we come to another very important terminology which we are going to do in detail later, which is diagonal relationship. What do we understand by diagonal relationship? As we are saying over here that the bridge elements, it has similarities with both the subgroups. It so happens that in diagonal relationship, the element will have similarities. Element has similarities with its own group . Okay, it is going to have similarity with its own group. At the same time, the second element of the next group like for example, if we have lithium, then we have beryllium, sodium, magnesium, boron, aluminium, then the next one that is going to be carbon and silicon. Okay, so when we are showing the diagonal relationship, we are saying that lithium shows a diagonal relationship with magnesium, beryllium shows a diagonal relationship with aluminium, and boron shows a diagonal relationship with silicon. Right? Which means that lithium and magnesium will have similar properties, beryllium will share some properties with aluminium, and boron will share certain properties with silicon. Why this is happening? Because when we move from lithium to beryllium, the size that decreases. But when we move from beryllium to magnesium, the size again increases. Okay, so as a result of which, lithium and magnesium should have comparable sizes. Because of the comparable sizes, they may have similar properties. Similar is the case over here, beryllium to boron size decreases, boron to aluminium size is going to increase, so they may have similar properties. Okay, have you understood? So this is diagonal relationship. Then after diagonal relationship, we say that the elements belonging to the same subgroup exhibit same properties same subgroup, like if you're talking of group A, that is same subgroup, either they should have similar properties or they should show gradation in properties. Gradation in properties means that, for example, when we're talking of atomic sizes, the atomic sizes in one of the subgroup, if we're talking of A subgroup, it should keep on increasing as we keep going down the group. Okay, so these are similar, these are gradation in properties, but they share the same chemical properties. All the group members, if we're talking from, we are taking lithium, we are taking sodium, potassium, rubidium and cesium, right? So lithium to cesium, the size that is going to increase, but it will have the same chemical properties. So either the properties they are going to be same or the properties will show a general gradation. Okay, but if they belong to different subgroups, if they belong to different subgroups, it is not essential that group A and group B, they should have the similar properties. In fact, they do not have same properties at all. Like if you are talking of group 1, so same elements, group 1, the elements are lithium, sodium. In subgroup A, it is lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium and cesium. But when we are going to subgroup B, we have all the coinage metals. What are the coinage metals? That is, in the group B, we are going to have copper, silver and gold. And they are placed like this, copper, silver and gold. Okay, so group A and group B, subgroup B, they have no similar properties at all. All of these, they behave as alkali metals because all, otherwise all the three, copper, silver and gold, they are going to behave as coinage metals. Okay, so these were some of the characteristics. Then what are the applications of the modern periodic table? Modern periodic table. The foremost and the most important application of the periodic table was classification of elements. The study of elements was very, very easy according to the modern periodic table. Okay? Knowing the property of one of the element, it was very easy to predict the properties of the rest of the group. So classification made the study of elements quite easy with respect to the haphazard arrangement which was given before by the scientist. Okay. Then number two, discovery of new elements. We have already studied that Mendeleev was so confident about his periodic table that he kept a lot of places empty in the periodic table where he would have thought of chances of new elements being discovered. Like we had done in the previous class, Eka Silicon and Eka, which was the second one, Eka Aluminium, right? So these places were kept empty depending upon the properties, because when he had kept these places empty, the properties were already explained by Mendeleev. So the new elements which were discovered, they fitted in these places very well, and there were further chances of discovering new and new elements. So we started with 31 elements when we started the history of the periodic table, and we have ended up to 118 elements. So this periodic table gave a chance for the new discovered elements and had kept proper places. Like you had seen the periodic table, there are still some unknown elements which are present which have not been named. Right? So they have been discovered but not named, but otherwise they were placed in places where they would have similar properties to the elements which are placed in those groups. So this was another application. Then correction of atomic masses. Correction of atomic masses. This was again a very big achievement of this table, because there were many elements whose masses were incorrect, and one example of this is beryllium. Right? The mass of beryllium was not correctly given. So by placing beryllium at after boron, after lithium in the periodic table, the mass was very properly explained. Okay? So the formula which was used to calculate this atomic mass was equivalent mass into valency. Equivalent mass into valency. Okay. So the equivalent mass of beryllium was calculated as 4.5, and the valency of beryllium according to the group was 2. So the atomic mass was approximately 9. Otherwise, the atomic mass was given by 14 point something was given for beryllium. Okay, then these were some of the achievements, but still, after the modern periodic table was given, there were still many defects in the table. So, let's study what are those defects. The defects in the periodic table, the first and foremost defect was position of hydrogen. Position of hydrogen, right? Now, hydrogen basically showed similarities to both alkali metals as well as halogens, as a result of which the position of hydrogen is still controversial. Even when we will do the next periodic table, we will see that still the position of hydrogen is not properly explained because it can show similarities with both alkali metals and halogens. Okay? Then the second one was similar elements were separated. Similar elements were separated. When we saw the periodic table, there were elements like barium and lead. Okay, so barium and lead, they had similar properties, almost similar properties, but barium is kept in the second group, whereas lead that is kept in the fourth group. So there was separation of similar elements. Similarly, Ag and tellurium, that is silver and tellurium, they have same properties. Still, silver is kept in the first group and tellurium is kept in the third group. So this was another major defect which had to be rectified and which was done in the next table. Okay? And then dissimilar elements were placed together. As we have seen just now, as in group 1 we just discussed that the alkali metals were placed in 1A, whereas the coinage metals were placed in group 1B. So they both bear no similarities at all, still they were kept together, right? Then there was the fourth one is that there was no distinction or idea given about metals and non-metals. Both were kept together, metals and non-metals. Both are kept together. Some of the metals and non-metals, they are separated, some are kept together. So there is no definite place where we can say that, okay, this area is the metals and this area is the non-metals. So placement of metals and non-metals is not properly explained. And the last one is position of transition elements. This was again a very big drawback. The transition elements, they were just kept haphazardly, as in when, like in the first group you see that the transition metals copper, silver and Ag. Copper, silver and gold, they all are transition metals, but they are kept in group 1. Similarly, group 8, which is known as the transition triads, then these elements, they are not placed with that. Iron, cobalt and nickel, they are placed in those. So transition elements, they are not given proper place in the periodic table. Okay, so this was the modern periodic table. Then in the next section now, we are going to study the periodic table, which are in actual we are studying as of today. Okay, which was a much better version than the periodic table which we have studied today. Okay.